Who are the presentation sisters? Well, there was a woman like you, not a nun, a woman started the presentation sisters. And how she did that, she lived in Ireland in the middle 1700s. Ireland was under the oppression or the heel or the domination, whatever word you want to use, of England at the time. And one of their goals, Protestant England, was to eliminate Catholicism from Ireland. And they did that the way you would always try to eliminate a belief system, is you oppress people, you keep them from being educated, can't own property. Anything you do that would be to propagate Catholicism would be treasonous. You might be imprisoned, you might be hanged. That was her country that she was growing up in, and she was a Catholic. Her parents smuggled her over to Ireland to get educated because you couldn't educate Catholic kids in Ireland. It was against the law. It was treason. She got educated. She was a wily, smart, ambitious, a little bit on the wild side woman, maybe like a lot of you might be. And in fact, her parents thought maybe they'd make a lady out of her over in Paris. Well, anyway, she had a wonderful life there in education, and then when her father died, she came home. And the contrast of where she had been, living this wonderful life that included partying and upscale living in those days, and then she comes home and sees the degradation of her people. Kids playing in the gutter, don't have decent clothes to wear, don't have food to eat, crime is rampant, and it consisted a lot of times of burglary and crimes that poor people commit because they can't survive, and then they get thrown into prison. They had a place called the Gallows Green where they hung people that got caught for burglary. So she looks at this, and she looks at where she was and her heart. She was the kind of woman who could not walk past trouble and be indifferent. So her gut just bothered her, something terrible. Well, she thought, what'll I do? I'll be a nun. So she goes back to Paris and joins a religious order. Well, that was peaceful and nice, but it didn't do a darn thing for the people back in home. So she quit that and went home. And of course, when she came home, her family was, they didn't like the fact she had left the convent, looked like a failure. So that was her first failure. Anyway, she found an empty garage, a mud brick garage that nobody was using, and she rounded up 30 little urchin girls secretly. This would be treasonous. She brought them there and started to teach them. Well, one day, her brother, whom she was living with, found it out, and he was furious. They could all be thrown in prison. Nano didn't care. Her heart had to do what her heart had to do. She had this calling. So, you know, over time, she convinced her family that this is a good thing to do, even if it's dangerous. So she sold everything in their house that she could sell, whatever she could do to support her ministry. In 9 months, she had 200 girls going to secret schools. She got a few women to help her, people like you, that would be engaged by this kind of effort. You talk about entrepreneurial passion, risk. Anybody would say, you're crazy to do this. Where was the risk manager when you made this decision? So anyway, within 3 years, she had 5 schools for girls and 2 for boys that she started. The penal laws were loosening up more by then. Well, anyway, she begged and borrowed. I don't think she stole, but she begged and borrowed. Maybe she stole from home, I don't know, to run these schools. And she got other women to help her. Well, finally, you know, she figured out, you know, you got to look at a future. You're going to plan, you got to have a future. So she decided, they decided together, 4 of them, that kind of like the core team, as it were, they don't use those words in those days, but the core team decided that they would be a religious community of nuns. That would have a future, permanent, you know? So they asked the bishop, and they started out as a group of nuns. Well, they thought that would grow, and they would have all kinds of help, and they could do lots of wonderful work. Well, it doesn't always happen that way, and it didn't grow. 8-10 years went by, and they had some women came to be sisters, but they didn't stay, because that particular challenge was one that not everybody would bite on, because there's no profit in that. There is only internal heart reward. You know you're doing what God asks you to do in the way God wants you to do it for God's poorest people. And so that's not a popularity contest, obviously. But anyway, they hung in there. Eventually, Nana literally wore herself to death. She got sick, got tuberculosis, and she died fairly young. And there were only three sisters left then. She had ulcers on her knees from spending hours at prayer. Nobody knew this. You know, they wore long dresses in those days. They didn't wear religious habits. They wore long dresses in those days. She had swollen feet. Well, anyhow, while she was teaching school, people would come to her for help. And so she started after work at the end of the school day. She would go out into all the hovels of Ireland where the old people were, poor people, sick people. See, there were no social services. So, and of course, if you're Catholic, you were really in trouble. There was nothing there for you. So at night, she would go out with a lantern, and she became known as the Lady with the Lantern. She'd go out at night and go into the homes and take food and whatever she could do for sick people, whatever medicinal help they had in those days. She'd do that at night. And she said to the sisters, and we have that in a quote. She said, "Instruct poor children, and when not teaching, minister to the sick, the poor, the downtrodden, the elderly, in their homes or wherever." Can you imagine saying that to a teacher now at the end of the day? When not teaching in school, you go out and minister to the sick, the poor, the downtrodden, the elderly, in their homes or wherever. Well, anyway, that was, so we've got teaching and we've got kind of like social services, healthcare, and an extreme dedication. And if you think it, and for 1 minute, this would have been easy. A lot of people didn't like it. They called her kids the street brats, and sometimes they'd insult her on the street. But she never said, "I will give up on this." Well, anyway, today there are presentation sisters in 23 countries of the world, and that goes back to her entrepreneurial passion and her ambitious spirit and her refusal to let difficulty get in her way. And that's a something for us. And another little, I think, piece of meaning to hold on to is she did this with a group of women. She never could have accomplished this on her own. She did this with a group of women. I think that's a very important thing. Well, anyway, when she died, she told the sisters, "Love one another as you have been doing, and spend yourself for the poor." You know, the poor are not an option. Taking care of the poor is a mandate of the gospel. It's not a choice. It's not an option. Well, anyway, she took that seriously. So this was her gift to the world. And in 1995, they took a poll in Ireland. 1995, she was 17, around 1750, those years. So 1995, over 200 years later, they took a poll in Ireland. Who is the greatest woman who ever lived in Ireland? Guess who won? Nan Nagel. And then in the year 2000, they gave her an award. You know, they announced that she was, I got it here. I never follow notes. I'm terrible about following notes. But anyway, she was noted for being the woman of the millennium. Millennium, you know, 2000, the millennium. She was the woman of millennium for educating girls and women in Ireland. Now that's rah-rah for women and rah-rah for Nano, right?